Now the second homework assignment here was a signup page. Here's my signup page. And the idea was you could type in a username and a password and an optional email if you want, and then click submit, and it will take you to a welcome page. Now, if you type in, you know, if you leave your passwords blank, you get an error message. If you don't enter both passwords in, it complains that they didn't match. If you give an invalid name, which in my case was, I made it be a minimum of 3 characters, it complains that it's not a valid name. And an email is optional. But if I type in something that's not a valid email, it complains. So if I type in an email, and then I type in some valid stuff, and hit submit, we get to the welcome page. Okay, let's look at the code for this real quick. Ah, one last thing I did I should show you. I double-checked to make sure the username is valid here, too. So if you put in an invalid name in the URL, it'll automatically redirect you to the signup page. Okay, let's take a peek at the code. Here is the portion of the code where we are doing the signup handler. You can see my URLs down here. I've got unit2signup goes to the class signup, and unit2welcome goes to the class welcome. And the signup page, if you just get it, it renders the empty signup form, which is another template that I'm using. I'll show you here. This is just HTML. Now, again, you could have used a big string, and most of you probably did. Here's my HTML. You can see it's got a form method post. I used a table to lay out the form. You don't have to do that. We didn't grade on the appearance of it. I just used a table to make my columns line up nice. The important part was we've got an input type text. Name is username. And the value, this is another template variable. And then the error, here's another template variable. You know, this could just as easily be, you know, %s in the way that you learned how to do it. We've got input type password, name password, value is blank. The value is blank here because whenever there's an error, I don't put the passwords back in the form field. If there's an error with the passwords, or if there's an error with anything, we make them retype their passwords. The password error field, the verify, input type password, name verify, that's for the verifying the password, and an error for that one. And then we've got our email, email optional. Type text, name, email, value, email. If there's an error with it, we'll leave it in there so they can update it. And then the error message for that field, and input type equals submit. And let's take a peek at the code for this guy. When you post to here, what I did is I have a variable called have error. And this basically, if we make it through this whole function and this is still false, then we render the success page. Otherwise, we render the error page. So first I get the parameters. I get the username, password, verify, email out of the out of the request. Request.get fetches those parameters. Then what I do is I run it through these functions that I've written. Valid username, valid password, and valid email. I've defined regular expressions. I believe we gave these to you for each of these. So a username is just A through Z, 0 through 9. You know, basically has to be between 3 and 20 characters. We provided this to you, and I think we showed you how to use regular expressions as well. So this function is very simple. If there's a username, basically if it's not blank, and it matches this regular expression, true. Password is a similar thing. Basically, any characters between length 3 and 20. If there's a password and it matches this regular expression, return true. And the email, the actual email regular expression to validate an email is comically long. It's thousands of characters. I use a simpler version, which is basically a bunch of characters, an at sign, a bunch of characters, a period, and then a bunch of characters. I find that works pretty well. If you try to get more complicated than that, there's a good chance you'll reject what would otherwise be a valid email. So I usually let, you know, if we're going to send emails to people, I let whatever tool I'm using to send the email, you know, that can break if the email's not valid. This gets us close enough. I think Reddit uses this regular expression still, and it's always worked fine. I think there's some limits to the length of this, but one more thing. I make this dictionary called params. And these are params I'm going to send back in to rendering. This would be similar to if you're using the string substitution to draw your HTML. You're basically going to build up this dictionary of the variables that you want to substitute in. So I'm always going to send back the username and email if it's a bad form. If the username wasn't valid, I add the error username to this params dictionary, and I set have error equals true. If the password isn't valid, here's the password error, have error equals true. If the password's valid and it doesn't equal the verify variable from the request, we say the passwords don't match, set have error equals true, and then email. A valid email, if you look, is different from the other ones. These ones say return password and. This one says return not email or. So what this is saying is either they don't specify an email or it has to match this regular expression. Everybody else says they have to give a password and it has to match the regular expression. That's how we handle the email's optional case. And then basically, if we have an error, I just render the signup form again with our error messages. And if we don't have an error, I redirect to this URL and putting in username into the URL as a get parameter. When we handle unit2/welcome, we come to this handler here, welcome. And we get the username out of the request using request.get. And then if it's a valid username, render the welcome HTML template, username equals username, or redirect back to the signup page. And the welcome HTML template is pretty short. All it is just basic HTML, and it says welcome, and then it includes the username. And that's that. So that was homework 2. I hope you managed to figure everything out. I hope you now, after seeing my solution with the templates and your solution with the string substitutions, are eager to start using these templates on your own. I'm not going to talk about them. I'm not going to teach you how to use them specifically, but there's plenty of documentation on the Google App Engine site, and I'm sure in the forums there'll be lots of activity as well. And also, we can provide these few lines here and this base class if you all would find that helpful. Okay, good job, everybody, and on to Unit 3.